Well, I want to say good morning to each of you this morning. It is a great Sunday to be together, and it's a great day to come together at Stones Hill. I so appreciate the entourage of announcements and those representing those ministries. They do a great job, and I'm so thankful for the leadership of so many here at Stones Hill, and it really makes this place a special place. So thank you for leading, and thank you for those of you who are a part of these ministries, and those of you who are participants in these ministries. It just really everything rises and falls on leadership, and so each ministry has a good visionary leader. It has a great opportunity to touch a lot of lives, and so we're very, very thankful for that. Thankful for your leadership. This morning we're continuing in a kind of a little mini series called Presence, and we certainly all need the presence of each other, and we certainly need to be a positive presence in the families that we're part of and in the groups that we're a part of, and we certainly need the presence of the Lord. And when I say presence of the Lord, I'm not saying necessarily it's something that we smell or something that we see or something that we hear, though those things can be involved. I'm not excluding that, but many times there's been special times in my own life when I've sensed the presence of the Lord. And I know how important that is, because I know in so many ways we look to so many, it seems like we're human beings and we're never satisfied with just simple, basic doing life day to day. We like the sensational things, the miraculous things. The noteworthy things, the highlights of life. And so many times life is lived down in the valleys. It's lived in the ordinary everydayness of our human existence. And it's in those moments that I think we really need the presence of the Lord. And of course, we're going to be revisiting and perhaps revisiting some passages in the Gospels that really we can sense the presence of Jesus in those passages. And of course, someone has said that if you read the Bible long enough, you'll see someone looking back at you. And the person that's looking back at you is Jesus. And when he's looking back at you from the Bible, so many times I think we have this notion that God is this cosmic, unblinking stare that we kind of picture this God that's just kind of looking at humanity, trying to figure us out. But in the person of Jesus, the stare becomes a smile. And so, for me anyway, when I read the Bible and I see the presence of Jesus in it, and he's looking back, he's not just looking at me in an unblinking, unfeeling facial expression. It is a smile that I see. He loves humanity. He loves you this morning. He loves the world. And he loves the beauty of the world, this multi-sensory experience in which we all are immersed. He loves the fact that we love life and have this life he's given to us to live. He loves this place. He loves what he's made, expressions of his love and grace and all of his attributes. So God is good, and he's present in our world in ways that if we just have eyes to see, we can sense his presence and know his presence. But there have definitely been times in my life when I've sensed his presence. I know I sensed his presence early in life, second grade. I had a childhood conversion, and I really feel that the Lord came into my life that evening, and I felt saved. I felt redeemed. But then I had to flesh that out, and I had to kind of grow in my walk with the Lord and try to figure out what all that meant, because I couldn't quite put words to what that meant at the time. And so I've kind of since done that, and I was kind of raised in an environment where there was a lot of external focus. In other words, being religious and looking religious was kind of how spirituality was expressed. And maybe that's your experience too. And what's so beautiful is that when we look into the life of Jesus, the stories that happened, that he, the miracles that he performed, or what he did to touch people's lives, or when we look at the parables that he shares, we get insight into the beauty of who Jesus was. And I love the fact that Jesus was for the underdog. I love the fact that he's for people who are reaching out to him, but they may not have the paraphernalia of religiosity sprinkled into their life. They may be just ordinary, marginalized kind of people, and yet somehow they give us these deep insights into spiritual life. And so you look, what we're going to look at today is a parable, one of the parables that Jesus told. And it was while he was on his way to Jerusalem, and so he's on his way, and the shadow of the cross is kind of hanging over his life. But he's on his way, and he's talking and communicating with the religious elites, we could say, the people who were the pastors and the leaders of that time. The Pharisees were the spiritual professionals. They had things figured out. They were very, very holy, very religious, very dedicated to the law. And we have this character, this person, contrasted with another person in this parable in Luke 18, and it was a tax collector. And it was a person that the Pharisee in the story chooses to stereotype and focus on this stereotype and let that be the essence of his righteousness. And we're going to look at that here this morning. Like I said, there's been other times that I've sensed the presence of the Lord in my life. And I sensed him different times. I think when I got married, I sensed his presence. When we had Megan, our first of three, I sensed his presence. Just the nearness, the fact that he was so other than me in those moments and yet so close. It's just an incredible moment. I think probably the most incredible worship experience I ever had was when in a birthing room of a hospital in Palm Beach Gardens, Florida. It's just God showed up there unlike any other time and place. And so I think we definitely need these times where we sense his presence and know his presence. And I think probably one of the most powerful times when we sense and see the presence of God, it comes to us in Jesus, in and through Jesus, and we recognize what Jesus has done for us. We recognize that he is our righteousness. And when you can turn over your life and let your life be covered by his righteousness, that's a moment. That's a moment. We all need a moment like that, where he is near to us and his presence draws close and we understand what he's done for ourselves and for the world. And so Jesus just kind of, like I said, he's in the whole Bible. He's looking back at us from within its pages, but it seems like his spirit, his presence just kind of circulates in some of these passages. And again, last week we looked at one, and then so this week we're going to look at another one of these in the Gospels. And it's a tale of two prayers. And if we go to slide number two, what you're going to see is you got two people in the story, and there's two prayers, a tale of two prayers. You're going to have one that says, "See me, God, I'm not like him. See me, God, I'm here. I hope you like what you see, and let me give you some help in seeing the things that you should like about me. And in fact, if you might ought to feel a little special, and you might ought to feel privileged that I'm even talking to you, God. See me, I'm not like him." And that's the essence and the extent of some spirituality, some people's view of the religious and spiritual life. There's another guy in the story, and his prayer is basically this: "Save me, God, I'm not like you." See the difference? "Save me, God, I'm not so much concerned about who's around me. But I see you and for what you are and who you are, and I've seen my life and I see how far I've messed up and how far I've been removed maybe from the full potential of what my life could have been. And I recognize that I am in a life, a mess that I can't get out of. I can't figure this out. Save me, God, I'm not like you." And these boys that pray this prayer, they're both longing for the presence of God, but they're going about it two very different ways. A tale of two prayers. You know, I'm learning a lot about presence these days, and I try to read broadly and consider a lot of different perspectives when I do a series or have a theme that I'm working, a sermonic theme I'm kind of working. And I'm working through a book called Presence by Amy Cuddy. And this is a lady who's done some groundbreaking work on our body language, our posture, how important it is in our life. And a lot of times, just the way we hold ourselves, and it says a lot about who we are and what we believe and what we're thinking. Basically, she says that there's two ways that you can carry your body. You can make yourself really big, or you can make yourself really small. Two ways we hold our body. Some sit up straight and stand up straight, and maybe their shoulders are high and they're spread out and they're taking up space. And it's a way of announcing to the world, you know, I'm here, this is my space. And that's kind of how they approach life. And so you make yourself big and open. And in the case of victory, maybe your arms are up or out. Or maybe your hands are on your hips and you're in a Wonder Woman pose, right? Go to slide number 7 for me. According to Cuddy, there's some high power poses, and that's a couple of them. And so basically we can make ourselves really big or we can make ourselves small. How many of you have seen your mom do that at home? Okay, whenever your mom does this at home, the fur is going to hit the fan. All right, let's just say it that way. Good old West Virginia jargon there. All right, the fur is going to fly, buddy. And when my mom gave me one of these, Joey Wayne Nelson, you know, you've done what? You said this, I'd been had. My goose had been cooked, and it was just a matter of time. Maybe you've had a coach do that, or maybe a teacher do that, or maybe a girlfriend or boyfriend or a spouse maybe assume the high power pose, right? Because something's going down and it's not good. And so sometimes, though, we present ourselves in such a way we're going to make ourselves look big and be big and feel big because we have a point we're wanting to make. And so, and then there's other times we can make ourselves small, according to Cuddy. We can cross our legs, fold our arms, hunch our shoulders, bow our head. We don't want to be noticed. Slide number 9. We don't want to be noticed. We just want to get as small as we can get. Maybe we feel inadequate. Maybe we feel guilt. Or maybe we feel out of our element or whatever, and we feel small. And so we try to just stay away from people and not bump into anybody, right? And just kind of be there and not be there at the same time. We make ourselves small. And this is basically the two ways that we can approach life. Well, what's really interesting to me is that we see this body language represented in the passage of the parable here in Luke 18. In fact, I don't know of another passage in the Gospels that really the nonverbals amplify the message any better than it does in this story. You have one guy that's trying to make himself really, really big. And you have one dude that's making himself really, really... In fact, he won't even stand near the guy that's making himself big, the spiritual professional. He stands out on the peripheral. And that may just seem a story to you today. It may just seem like a story. It may just seem like, oh, this is just something that doesn't really matter to us today, right? But this stuff plays out all the time. It really does. In fact, here at Stone Sail, you'd be surprised. Sometimes I'll be preaching and speaking, and I'll look back and I'll see someone peeking through the glass, and maybe they won't even stay. They won't even stay. Maybe they don't even feel like they're worthy enough to come into sanctuary and sit down. But they've come and they peek through, and when the amen said, they're out the door. So this stuff gets lived out. We have people who make themselves really big. And sometimes, you know, we can make ourselves really big, and we're the professionals, and we got this figured out, and this is my space. And other times you have people who have so much to teach us in life who feel really, really small for whatever reason. And this is why this story touches me so much. It's because I cannot imagine living life in such a way that my presence conveyed this feeling that you don't matter. That my presence somehow says to other people that may not be like me, that may not have my label, that may not have my identity necessarily or my viewpoints or my beliefs, that somehow something about my presence would alienate and cause others not to want to be a part of something that's really important for all of us. And so it's important for us to think about this. And so what we have here in this story is you've got two guys. One is praying, see me, God, I'm not like him, and he's making himself really big. The other one's praying, save me, God, I'm not like you. And when I think about that, I think about the one of the finest New Testament scholars Dallas Seminary has ever produced, Daryl Bach, he says in his NIV application commentary, he says, this parable, and we're going to read it in a second, we'll work our way through it. This parable is really the parable of the two prayers. In those prayers appear two kinds of hearts whose contrast is not only seen in the way they make their request, but also in the way they approach God. Their body language is an indication of how they're going to approach God and how they're going to approach life. And what we see here is on slide number 3. To some who were confident of their own righteousness and looked down on everybody else, Jesus told this parable. To some who were confident of their own righteousness. What's our theme? Righteousness. And I read this week how one person, one speaker referenced this, the problem of righteousness. And I'm thinking, what's the problem of righteousness? I didn't think righteousness had a problem. Well, what's the problem of righteousness? And he says it's a universal problem, this problem of righteousness. And we see that what Jesus is going to do, he's going to address the problem of righteousness, and he's going to use these two guys to do it. And he's going to show us each of them and their approach to address or to solve the problem of righteousness. One solution does not work, and that's the outside-in approach. And that's the approach of the religious guy in our story. And there's another approach that does work. It's the inside-out approach, and that's the approach of the tax collector in our story. And Tim Keller makes this point so well. He says in every culture, there's a different form of it, but there's a hunger for something. There's a hunger for approval. There's a hunger for acceptance. There's a hunger for a verdict over our life that you're okay and I'm okay. And so we need someone from outside of us to come in and say, Joey, you're approved. You're approved. You're good. You're worthwhile. You're great. Someone from the outside has to say, you're all right. Someone from the outside has to assure us that we're okay, but somehow yet it never seems to be enough. And that's what Keller calls is a problem of righteousness. We're all looking for this. We're all looking for this approval, this significance. And the problem of righteousness is the theme of this story. Righteousness means to be approved. It means to be accepted, to pass scrutiny. It means that, and it's a problem that we all have. And Jesus says, let me tell you one common way people deal with it that doesn't work. And let me show you another way that people deal with it that does work. And that's kind of the thought process and the background information, the backstory of kind of what's going down here in the story. And so he proceeds to tell us this. And he says in Luke 18:9, he says, you know, there's some who are confident of their own righteousness and they look down on everybody else. And Jesus told them a parable. He says, two men went up to the temple to pray. And so they're both seeking presence. They're seeking the presence of God. And it's interesting, when you stepped onto that temple mount, and I've been there and tried to picture this, but when you stepped onto that temple mount in Jesus' era in the first century, you stepped into a multi-sensory world, a multi-sensory experience. There were visual aids everywhere. You saw you could envision the utter separation and the lostness of sin through the slaughtering and cutting of animals. You smelled the incense burning. You saw the cloud of smoke rising. You watched the elaborately adorned priests do their work. You heard the blast of trumpets. You heard the clash of cymbals. And the Levitical choir would be chanting a psalm. And they had these public demonstrations of just trying to visualize the presence of God, trying to help everybody who would walk onto that temple mount. And it was up from everything else. It's kind of up and elevated a little bit. these guys go up to the temple. They're seeking the presence of God. They're trying to encounter God. They know that it's important to feel and be in the presence of God. And so this is what they were attempting to do. And these guys were coming, stepping into this environment. And one was a Pharisee, and one was a tax collector. It's interesting because they're two opposites. You have one that's a religious professional and one that's just kind of out there. He's bid for the rights to tax the people. Many times they would overtax and pocket the difference. And so they were hated by the religious establishment. They were hated and despised by the community. And also they were seen as collaborators with Rome because Rome was behind the taxation and things. And so these guys had a stereotypical reputation. They not only did that, but they did a lot of other things. And the Pharisee, you're going to see in just a second, he'll kind of note some of those stereotypical things that were in the life of this tax collector. One's a Pharisee, the other's a tax collector. Now look what happens in verse 11. The Pharisee stood up. He makes himself really big. He stands up. Gets himself spread out. He's big. He has big body language going on. He's going to make himself look big. He wants God to see him. And not only God to see him, but even more importantly, he wants other people to see him. So he stands up. He's in a position of strength. And if you want to be in a position of strength, you'll stand. And he stands, according to one commentator, in the inner court of the temple. He thrusts out his chest. He pulls in his stomach. He clears his throat. He adjusts his posture. He tips his head back just a little bit so the nose is slightly elevated. He steeples his fingers, and this spiritual alpha male begins to pray with eyes lifted toward heaven, making himself really, really, really big. He says, God, I thank you. No problem there. We all need to have gratitude. But he says, I thank you. And then watch where he goes. That's the last reference to God in the prayer. I thank you. And then he notes what he doesn't do and what he does do. And both of them are a misplaced righteousness. On the front of your bulletin, you're going to see a quote. The irreligious don't repent at all. And that many times is the case. Maybe you see yourself, you're here today, but you've seen yourself as irreligious in the past. That's okay. We all have been. But you haven't really thought about repentance and don't really think about that. Maybe you are in these days, but the irreligious don't repent at all. The religious only repent of sins. And boy, this Pharisee, he knew how to repent of certain sins. Of course, he wasn't going to admit any, but he knew how to do that. And the religious know how to repent of sins. God, I did it again. Forgive me. We know how to do that. We're religious. But you know what Keller says? What I think Jesus is after? Christians, those who follow Christ, repent of a wrongly placed righteousness. So we don't just repent of sin, we repent of the sin behind the sin. Because we recognize whether I'm like the Pharisee and I checklist all the important things I think a religious person is supposed to do. Or if I obey God's law and place righteousness in my obedience, or if I flaunt God's law and throw restraint to the winds and do whatever the heck I want to do in my life, either way, there is a sense of rebellion in either approach. When we place our righteousness in those things. And Jesus, who's telling this story, helps us to see that what the gospel says is that now, rather than doing good, rather than just doing evil and trying to elucidate all of our wrongs in life and confess all of them, rather than those two approaches, we recognize that there's something in us that's internally flawed. That we reject relationship with God. We reject His presence. And we construct these elaborate ways of trying to make ourselves look better and approachable and approvable. But in the end, it's Jesus and Jesus alone, in whose righteousness one must trust. And outside of that, there is no peace. And he goes on to die for these guys in Jerusalem. He dies for publicans. He dies for tax collectors. He dies for the Pharisees. And he invites them to put their trust in him. And so what we see is a misplaced righteousness. And if we're not careful, we can let the spiritual life kind of go that direction, that we trust these other things. And so he stands to his feet. He makes himself big. God, I thank you that I am not like other men. Oh, no. Now he's going to do the stereotype and the comparison game. I'm not like the robbers, the evildoers, the adulterers. And so when you compare your righteousness with others, you can always find a comparison that allows you to feel good at yourself. What is righteousness? I want approval. I want someone telling me that I'm okay. That my life matters and that I'm a good person. And we will do the comparison thing. And so we start comparing and we start looking externally at righteousness. And he says, I'm not even like this tax collector. And notice the derogatory tone. He says, this tax collector. It's almost as if he holds his nose while he says it. I'm not even like this guy. And he's kind of peeking, he's on the external of what's happening. He's on the very margins. He just can't even bring himself to come into the sanctuary. He's kind of on the outside in the peripheral. And this tax collector is really waxing eloquent about how great he is. And he sees the tax collector and he orients his prayer that direction. And then he says, in verse 12, this is what I'm not like. This is what I do. I fast twice a week. You know, I have looked high and low. I've read a lot of resources this week. And you know, every one of them are verifying something. There was only one fast required in the Old Testament. One day a year on the Day of Atonement. No other requirements. There was other fast times and seasons, but not required. What does he do? I fast twice a week. Notice how many times the first person pronoun I appears in the story. I do this. I do that. I don't do this. I fast twice a week. I'm going above what's required. I'm exceeding the minimum requirements. Way past. And I give a tenth of all I get. I don't just tithe my crops. I tithe my garden herbs too and my spices. Careful to measure out a tenth. And so what's really interesting, he never admits any need. And all he can do is really recite the good deeds, perhaps not enough for other people to hear him. And what a great religious person that he is. And what Jesus means to show us and point out to us is it's a misplaced righteousness. And the tax collector, verse 13, but the tax collector stood at a distance. Now the contrast. He made himself really, really small. He normally would not be welcome, but you know, he was there and he felt compelled to go on this day, and he wouldn't even look up to heaven, but he beat his breast and he said, and he just beats his breast as if to mark the spot of his great, great disconnect from God. You know, his body language indicates this emotional state. There's fear, there's anxiety. He's horrified maybe at what he's seen in his life, the hurt that he's caused other people. He's intimidated by the super religious. He's nervous about being in the temple area, perhaps seeing people that he's actually cheated but can never repay. Embarrassed by the life he's led, remorseful for the wrongs committed, sorrowful about the God he has ignored. And he keeps clutching his chest. And he says, you know, God, I know you're there, but I'm messed up. And I want your presence, but I don't know how to get it. I need you. God, have mercy on me, a sinner. And the tax collector, He comes to God with no self-congratulation. And he realizes something about himself, that if he ever has hope of a new and a better life, and gets a vision for a better way, a higher way, a better way, a more in tune way with the way he's created to live and really meant to be. And so in desperation, he cries out to God, "God, I need your provision to cover me." And Jesus has this to say, verse 14, "I tell you that this man went down to his home justified rather than the Pharisee." This man, he received a sense, God's righteousness. And so in the story, you know, you've got the external outside in approach. You got one guy saying, "See me, God, I'm not like him. I behave myself most of the time. I keep the rules. I watch my language. I check my bad habits. I sometimes put money in the offering. Sometimes I keep myself from the rule breakers. I stay away from people who don't share my values. I stay away from places or processes that might hinder my reputation. I stay away from books or websites or places where my values are not represented there. I'm part of the good guys of the world." It's an outside-in approach. And Jesus, who's going to die for all of us, who understands how we work at this sometimes, he says it's never going to work. It's never going to solve the problem of righteousness. If we reduce the spiritual life to checklist kinds of things, it will never work. We're still going to be reaching out for approval, for some kind of a reason that we matter. And then, you know, you see this internal outside approach, and I relate to it so well. This other guy who's saying, "Save me, God, I'm not like you. I'm not like you. Save me, God." He's saying, you know, "All I know is I'm lost. And everybody else, you know, what they're doing doesn't matter. It's me, and I've got this separation between myself and my walk with God and my Creator." And he certainly wouldn't approve that, you know, robbery is okay and adultery is okay and doing all these other things that maybe would characterize and stereotype him as a person that is evil or whatever. He certainly wouldn't necessarily approve of those things, and I don't think that we any of us would. But this tax collector, he does something that I think we all have to do when it comes to the problem of righteousness. And that is, we have to get to the place where we confess and we talk to God about the sin behind the sins. About the fact that how many times have we pulled out of relationship with you that we shouldn't have? How many times have we avoided your presence? How many times have I not made right decisions that would allow your glory to be expressed in my life in a greater way? How many times? And so, and when we look at the spiritual life this way, and we all, basically, when you look at these two guys, you kind of have to come to the same place, the same conclusion, because, you know, we have to say, you know, "Lord, there have been periods in my life which I've lived pretty badly, and I've done things I shouldn't have done. I've kind of been like the tax collector, and there are periods in my life when I've been pretty good, and I've kept my nose clean, and I've done the right thing, but now I see the reason I did the good things was pretty much the same reason for which I did the bad things. I always wanted to be my own savior. I always wanted to be a taxpayer with rights. I always wanted to be religious or non-religious, but either way, it was the same deal. I'm still hungry for approval. I'm still hungry to have someone say my life is okay. And I've taken a couple different approaches at it." And see, I think we all have to come to the place where we repent of the motivation that has been driving us all of our life. That if somehow I do what's right, I'm approved. If somehow And if I don't do what's right, I'll approach life on my own terms and try to find my approval that way. But I think Tim Keller tells us right. And Jesus' story indicates to us the irreligious don't repent at all many times. The religious only repent of sins. But Christians repent of their wrongly placed righteousness. And so this morning, as you think about this story, as you think about some of the things I've shared with you, how is it in your life, especially spiritually? Are you making yourself really, really big? But inside, there's something not right. You know, I have no problem with bringing enthusiasm and confidence and passion to life. But when we look at this story and we see that maybe we're all trying to feel important in ways that and in ways that are contrary to gospel. Maybe our needs or opinions, we view them as maybe more important than someone else's. Maybe we make our demands of our spouse. Maybe instead of parking in one spot, we park in two. Maybe we talk more than we listen. Maybe we fold our arms way too often. Maybe we go around with this idea that maybe my life matters. I'm righteous. And maybe I'm good. And maybe I make sacrifices. And I'm not getting what I deserve. And we make ourselves really big. And then maybe this morning we make ourselves small. There's times we need to get off the radar. I understand that. There's times when maybe we get small in life. But if our shoulders are always hunched and our eyes are always diverted downward and our posture is closed off from others, it says something about how we see ourselves. It says something about what's happening on the inside. And that maybe even through our body language, we feel this estrangement from feeling like we're okay. Friends, there's no way we'll ever feel we're okay outside of the righteousness of another. And the righteousness of the other is the Lord Jesus Christ. And you and I need Him this morning to cover our sin, to cover our rebellion, to cover our estrangement from a right relationship with Him. So sometimes we make ourselves big and we get religious. Sometimes we make ourselves small and we know we've gone astray, and we know we've blown some opportunities, and we know we've not lived life the way we should have. And then I think there's sometimes a mindset that we can bring to life where even though we may feel really small and inadequate at times, there's a commitment to be used by God. There's a commitment to let His presence work through our life. There's a commitment to let Him work even through our words, our body language, the way we treat other people. An open posture, a mindset of service to touch someone's life today. Like I said last week, that there's truly no throwaway day, that every life matters, that every moment matters. And that somehow the presence of Jesus can come through that, and He can shine really big in my small life. And I think that's what He does here. That's what Jesus is after here in our story. He's showing us something that is at the heart of the gospel. And so this morning, I think it is. It might be time in your life for you to rightly place your trust in His righteousness and not our own. So one, we rebel a couple of two ways. One, we keep God's laws and make our demands. We break God's laws and live any way we want. But anyway, either way, we're looking to be okay. We're looking to be approved. We're looking for someone to tell us our life matters. And the only way you're going to find an answer to that question is if you continue on in Luke and you see the end of the story. Or there's a guy who is nailed to a cross. And he becomes the righteousness, our righteousness, your righteousness. And so if I've got my righteousness placed in Him and Him alone, what does that mean? Well, what it means is I don't have to be in church, or I don't have to go up to a temple to experience the presence of God, to sense His presence. He can't be contained in buildings. He has chosen to dwell in and through Jesus, and His presence is throughout our world, and we don't have to necessarily go, even though we sense and feel His presence at times in gatherings of His people, and that's awesome, but He's not restricted to that. His presence overflows into our life, and such that we sense and feel Him in birthing rooms and conversations and walks or runs or hikes or in other places. We sense His presence. And it can't be restricted. See, we're secure in His righteousness, and we can live from that. That can be our identity. As I look at this morning, and I think about sensing God, I think about all the stereotypes in our life where we dictate to God the type of people He's allowed to use to speak truth to us. But sometimes it's the person you never would think would be the one through whom truth could ever come. And it is. And on this occasion, on this day, in the temple, His truth comes through a tax collector of all people. Sometimes we think, well, His truth has to come through the person with the right political label. It's got to come through the person with the right identity, with the right lifestyle, with the right habits and patterns and attitudes. So many times it is from those who have a moment of epiphany, a moment when His presence is realized and they're reaching out for a covering mercy. And maybe that's where you are this morning. Yeah, we're going to play this closing song. And maybe this is a great opportunity for you to publicly go on record and say, you know what? I want to do what you're talking about this morning. I want to place my trust in the righteousness of Christ alone.